Freezing garage. My God, it was about 10 below zero. Felt like it anyway. And we had gotten on about 5 coats of clear onto the wing. I'm gonna let this dry out the rest of this day. We're doing some Christmas decorating around the house, of course. And if you saw our little village on the last layout, and I hope you don't mind sharing that with us, it's been a lot of fun having it. It's been a lot of fun sharing it. And I'm really looking forward to in the next week or so. A lot of things have to get done because we're planning on starting up that Spitfire of 1998 next weekend when Bob and Joe Adamusco, Bob Martens and Joe Adamusco come over. Looking forward to a real think tank session, get that project going and kind of finish this guy up or get as much of him done as we can. Now, I want to let that wing dry up a little bit more. The dope was just a little bit sticky on it. It was balling up when I tried to sand it. So I took all the scrap wood, and this is just a little idea you might be able to use for some other project in your house. Took all the scrap wood that was left over from making up that fireplace. Made myself up a rack, and what this rack is, this was Carlos Serra's idea. The VCR is all fitting here. See, the way I have them now, one stacks on top of the other. And they constantly, you have to take the bottom one out and it's a pain in the neck. This will give me actually a lot more choices as far as replacing, and believe me, these things need constant maintenance. So this is really a nice little idea. If you have more than one VCR, obviously you could make two little pieces like that. And I also have it, I'm putting it on a Lazy Susan so that I can spin it around and change the wiring in the back. So with all this, this will be a good project. And I guess the biggest lesson here is when you're running off to sand the wing, you do a little test and it starts coming up like chewing gum on the sandpaper, let it dry another day. So we'll just put that aside to dry by the heating vent for a day. It's a little, we're really rushing the finish on this and I don't want to do that. Now at this stage, I'm aware of two things. I tried this yesterday and it didn't work because the paint was balling up, so I just quit. But what I want to do, number one thing is fold a piece of 320 or 220 sandpaper back over itself and get in all the hinge lines. Now I know everybody that builds this way, this is a constant pain in the neck. In fact, Kenny's been suffering along with it with the Nobler, is keeping the hinge lines free. And if you don't, what'll happen when you tissue this and get in there with tissue, everything's going to lock up. You won't have those nice free controls. Now, sometimes you have to spend the whole day doing this. So far, these have been pretty good. Again, when you're very careful about putting the hinges in, it just, each step of it makes the next step easier and easier and easier and better and better and better. So, I want to check all of these. And I want to see if I can get some of this dope to powder off. Most important thing right now is, at least for me, if I was to try to do this yesterday, I would be rushing it and everything would be balling up and leaving a little sanding swirls. I think I did the right thing by spending that extra day of waiting. But one of the things I want to have is nice, neat hinge lines if possible. And if you go back and do a ship like we did the Spitfire, Seafire, Strega, whatever, Tsunami, where you have parts that you don't install the hinges actually till a plane is buffed out, and then you do a plane this way, it seems like it's a lot more time consuming to do it this way. But again, you always want to try each way that you possibly can and do the way that suits you the best. You never want to get locked into any one way. And of course, there's nothing binding on this so far. Everything has stayed in good alignment. The fact that it dried outside where it was very cold, it prolongs the drying, but in the long run, I think ultimately it gets better penetration. Now keep in mind what really happens. All these edges, first time you put dope on the wood, it swells out, then it returns to a set. A second time, it expands a little bit less than the first time, and at some point in time, it locks in. All the wood cells, the little gaps in between the wood cells are fixed. Now, we're hopefully at that point now, so that any radiusing we do now is going to stay in the final, actually the final finish. You would hope, anyway. If you've wet the wood down the first time enough, at some point in time, you've got that good penetration. I want to radius all the edges off, and this is the difference. A lot of times you'll be saving this, you'll be sorry that you didn't spend a little extra time here, I should say. Now, Kenny, it's proven in the sand outs that he's had on that Nobler, they've been real good. He's been picking away at every little mistake you possibly could find. And again, the object of all of this is to get the plane as nice as possible. You can always take shortcuts, you can always monocoat. There's a lot of other choices if you just want to get a plane in the air. But in this case, since this is a prototype plane, I'd like to make it as nice as possible. I got that little Bob Martin sanding block, which is nice and flat for... I want to go over each one, and I like to do it with my finger. Your finger doesn't lie. Not a good idea to even look at them. Just go down each one. This is the only part of it I'm going to do with a sanding block. When I sand this, I'll sand it with a soft block or my bare hand, because I don't want to thin out the wood by each rib. I don't want to just hit the high spot. This wood tends to do this, and you'll make it too thin by the rib if you do it that way. Again, a very important step in the finish, because the nicer we can get it right now, assuming tomorrow or the next day we get the tissue this, every little ripple that the tissue doesn't have to go over is one less spot you're going to have to work on endlessly to get the little flaws out. And this is the kind of thing that really always shows up in a final finish. A little time spent here. Whatever hour you spend now, you're probably going to get back about 10 to 1 when you start sanding out the silver. Or even if you monocoated it, it would just be spots that you didn't have that you had to go over to monocoat with. The little Brodak tip weight box worked out real well. But again, each time I'm taking it out, radius in the edges. So I get those nice radius edges. If you don't, what happens in the final finish, everything here is like a razor blade, and you buff right through or you sand right through one way or another. Thing, of course, edging out all the corners around the outside of the tip weight box. Now all of the joints here is another spot that after the wood swells and settles down, see the way I work this tip shape is right into the corner. In fact, I remember showing Robert this trick. The only place I don't want to use a sanding block is on the thin sheeting, because there's no way that sheeting is going to stay perfectly straight. Now maybe on a wing that you used harder sheeting, you know, 12-pound sheeting or something, it would, but this is kind of light wood. And a leading edge is one area where I always like to spend a little more time than I would on the other parts of the plane. Here's a reason. You take a plane to appearance judge, and the first thing the judge does is go down a leading edge to trailing edge to see how the edges are. Any good judge would do that anyway. I remember Billy Werwidge and I doing that when we judged pylon at the 89 Nats. We judged the pylon, the appearance judging. Zingo, all the pilots weren't used to having that done. I guess the pylon people are not that critical. Again, it's just a question of spending the time now. Any time you spend, you know you're putting it in the bank. And now you can see the stuff is really powdering off. So it was worth waiting that extra day. A the most frustrating things to do is you're using a little sanding block and you go like this and break a cap strip. Yeah, I usually wind up doing that at least once in the course of building a plane. But away, when you want to get this little corner as close as possible, reference off the point. Now you have all angles. When you're sanding that in, there's no way you can break the cap strip now, or a lot less of a chance. See, there's no, you're always catching it on an edge. You never want to catch it on a flat angle. That's the mistake. So if you do each one like this, move it over to the next one, you can get them really perfect. And boy, when the sun hits that wing and you see the light bouncing off of the ribs, not many things in life less, less, more impressive. I can remember that 30 years later, seeing a light bounce off Jerry Sipper's wing.
Again, all of the sheeting, just doing it with the palm of my hand, fingers, trying not to press down too hard. The sheeting, when it's like this, is still kind of delicate. Now, one of the benefits we get by doing it this way, by if we had put the wing in a body first, I'd never be able to get the middle of the wing double tissued, and I want to double tissue the middle of the wing. That always adds quite a bit of strength in my estimation anyway. Plus, with these extra little pieces in here, I think this will be a real nice and rigid wing without being real heavy. It's easy to make a wing strong as long as you're not trying to make it too light. But to get it light and strong, difficult. I just want to work the absolute top of each cap strip, and that's pretty much going to do it. I'm going to put this aside to dry. Now, Karen's off of work today, so obviously we're not going to be doing any doping in the house. But we'll try to get a session in either tomorrow or whenever. Get this tissue and get that drying. Last thing, each spot. Any spot you feel, just use your fingers to find the spots.
Okay, totally sanded out, ready for silk span. We'll put that aside for the next session. Now, in today's mail, this came from Paul Winter from England, and he's going to be down here in the middle of April for a week to visit, I hope visit us, the hobby shop, the circle burners, whatever. He built this copy of Tsunami and really did a nice job. I think it really looks neat. Notice the, looks like a custom-made muffler. Did the wave, did the lettering, even did the lettering up top. Notice the AMA numbers in Great Britain is a G, I guess. Anyway, some nice pictures here. They sent about a 10-page letter telling me how hard it was to do this wave. Paul, you don't have to tell me. Difficult. He did this all by airbrush. Anyway, kind of a nice custom muffler here. Kind of looks a little bit like a Randy Holcroft muffler. In fact, it looks like he took a Pro Stunt Products muffler. Look at the flutes. Machined off the end and put the tube on. Anyway, find out when he gets here. Anyway, thanks to Paul Winter. We'll send him some pictures from the amazing Windy Picture Collection. Appreciate it a whole lot, and I appreciate he's going to write up a little thing for Stunt News about doing the wave, I hope. Paul, get on it. Now, to show you how cool Paul is, he knows Uwe Degner, and he's going to buy, when he's here in the States, buy an American VCR just so he can play those world-famous Windy videos. Hey, is that ever cool? Paul Winter of England. Now, in a catalog I just received today from Klingsport, I'm looking at these flexible sanding things, and B and I was making that VCR, and I didn't bother even sanding it. I didn't want to make a big deal out of it. I was just thinking how nice this might have a modeling application, and it looks like they have some real nice and small ones that might fit into the Dremel, and even if they didn't, all you'd need to do is turn the shank down on a lathe, which John Pothier has done for me many times. Anyway, again, old catalog city, and I've been sitting here daydreaming, picking out my, Karen doesn't know it, picking out my future Christmas present, thinking of so many things I would love to have in the shop here. And I notice a lot of the new tools, the modern tools, they have these little sanders, and see, they have a tube that hooks onto the shop vac so it keeps the dust to a minimum. These are all things you might want to consider. I've had so many inquiries about that dust bench thing that was in Model Aviation. In fact, I see there's a million other ones now that... Hey, this is a catalog you probably want to add to your list. Now this comes from, I won't mention any names. I know it comes from Glenn and Dawn Calado. But they always send it anonymously, and I think that's cute. They always send it to Bert and Ernie Ertnowski. And this is, I thought, oh boy, Bert and Ernie got a Christmas card. I flip it over, and all it is a hi. Hey, I think that's so cute, and I'll go over and hang it by the Bert and Ernie Christmas card collection. Now, he's still recovering. He still doesn't swim totally straight, but thanks to John Pothier, and thanks to the internet, and thanks to a lot of good others, he goes upside down. He's still getting better day by day, though. The Bert and Ernie fish. See, there's no problem. He goes right side up to eat. He just sleeps upside down all day. Bert and Ernie. And thanks for the card. And by the way, hey, I'm keeping a collection of their cards right on the side of the tank here. I think that's really neat. In anticipation of getting started on the new Spitfire, I went through the shop, spent a couple hours doing some organizational things that I like to do before each real building season, I guess. I always get a brand new block of scrap wood, stick all the knives in, this way you keep from cutting your fingers up unnecessarily. Get out all my spare motor for doing a cowling, all my extra blades, all my glue, organized all my sanding dowels. This was getting kind of messy. By the way, these are all old motor boxes. Organized all my sanding blocks, got all my supplies in order here. Got the table all cleaned up. Again, another box just for the nail files. Look at this. You can't get away from the phone.
Of course, of organizing stuff every year. Every year I seem to accumulate more and more these little Dremel bits and everything, and I plan on getting a bunch more for Christmas. So I figured I'd spend a little time. I have wood left over from working on that fireplace. Good old piece of pine. You can set it up with some kind of a grid that you're comfortable with. This makes a real nice little organizing stand for all your Dremel bits. And you know how crazy you get when you're looking for the certain one or the sanding drum or something, and you just can't find it. Now, I always think, just like everything else, there's a certain amount of shop maintenance. And it's this time of year I like to go through and just take a little inventory. Some of the Dremel bits that are beaten up, chewed up, some of the stones are worn down. It's a good time of year. Christmas is coming. And having this little grid helps you keep it a little better organized. We used to just have this in a coffee can lid. It's a nice little thing you can make up in a matter of a few minutes. Now, you'd be surprised how many cute little things you can make with scrap wood that'll help you organize. It takes probably 8-10 minutes. In fact, I'm just finishing writing something for Stunt News that basically putting down a lot of these little things, like organizing your tools, your glue, your... This is just the handiest little thing for all the Dremel bits. Obviously, if you have a lot of quarter-inch drill bits, you just make the same piece of wood with quarter-inch holes.
This was the first one of these little guys that I had made. This was one I used down at the machine shop, and I outgrew that right away. A couple of years later, made up a bigger piece. And you can see what I've done is, over the years, just because I've outgrown these things, been using jar caps and bottle caps. Now I'm gonna try to get this all nice and organized, get all my bits the ones I use all the time. All the junk spare ones can go there, but all the ones that you normally would use all the time. By the way, I was organizing this, I put up this rack for some of the VCRs. I don't have the other ones back yet, but basically getting that organized was a big step in the right direction. And it's got a lazy Susan down here, so if I have to do any rewiring, normally these things become a nightmare of snarled wires behind. Well, what I can do right now, I just pull that away a little bit, rotate it. Very easy to get at the wires. Even Carlos Serra was very impressed. Again, all these organizational things, they always help in the world.
I mean, personally, because Duracell batteries.
There's nobody home but the Jets corps. Real action around Christmas time. First down, New York. Playing old section today. Those hands to the face. Anderson, first kick in field position. Starting to hurt the Buffalo Bills.
Just a couple little things like this, when you get them organized, your life just seems to go by a lot smoother. At least mine does. And no money at all. Free. Little guy, we got one of the woodworking supplies worth its weight in gold already. I can see it's much better than where we had it before. I'm not walking into it. Keeps all the little things that you use all the time organized right at your fingertips. Again, inexpensive, quick. Now I've had to wait, and it's been, I don't know, it's been raining for 2 days here, and I haven't been able to get anything done. And I can't really paint in a house, but what I've tried to do is use this time. You can see the driveway is still full of puddles. Use this time to set up a little permanent table in the garage, which I think we're going to be using probably for the rest of the winter or until George gets his little shop set up, Ken's shop, whatever you want to call it, over in George's factory. Now what I basically want to do in this session, and I don't have a whole lot of time, but the little time I have left, I want to get this doped. This is already sanded, already doped. 5-6 coats, I don't remember. It's all edged off and everything. I'd like to get it tissued today if I possibly can. That would be my ultimate goal, if I can get this all tissued. Tomorrow, Bob Martens, Joe Adamusco are due in here nice and early, and we'll have a good session. Now, I always set this up first by checking all the spots, make sure I don't have any rough spots that I don't want. Second thing, I've got the dope really thin. A lot thinner than I normally would, because it's cold out here. It's definitely cold. It's under 30 degrees because there's ice in a pond. Anyway, I look it over, give it one last look. See, like right here, I can see I need to hit that with a little sandpaper. Look it over. Any little spots that aren't right, I get a couple of scalpels ready here. Get me a little jar of Windex. I'm going to cover this with the wet method. And hopefully get this all done today. And it can be sitting out here drying while we're discussing this new I-beam Spitfire project, which is just dominating my mind right now. Now this is always my material of choice for open bays and for doing real nice finishing. ST002 GM White. The idea here is I lay out one piece of tissue. I want this piece of tissue to come almost to the cap strip area. Get a nice new XL blade. I can trim a lot of this off ahead of time. Again, this is another spot. It seems like if you use new blades, you can save a little, especially just trimming this stuff off. Such a nuisance to trim when you don't have new blades.
I want to lay out the both sheets. The idea is I want to do this as quickly as possible. When you dilly-dally and take all day to do it, what happens? One side of the wing starts warping. It's a problem. So I usually would recommend, if somebody was doing this for the first or second time, that you do one side, then flip it over and do the other side. But I can usually go fast enough that I can keep both sides going. Usually. That usually is a big word, if you notice. Anyway, what I want to do is just dampen this up with some Windex, and usually just damp, not wet. Just dampen it up. Trick I want to use, not really a trick, but is to get everything prepared. I want to get all the silk span cut. This is one of the areas you can really make some time up on. What will happen a lot of times is you do one panel. By the time you get ready to do the second panel, you got to go cut the tissue, dampen it. Oh, man. It just takes forever. So I know I have a pattern now for one piece. I want to cut all four pieces of my tissue and have them all ready to go. So I do one panel, flip it over one panel as quickly as possible. And then I'm cutting all four at once here, cutting over a blanket. We got a whole bunch of new old blankets to use, save all the scraps. Now I know I have four pieces all the same. Again, the only reason for doing this is to try to get this whole thing. If this was an all-perfect world, what you'd like to have is to be able to do all four at the same time, or if you had two helpers, two, flip it over two, would be nice, but this is a compromise. Now, one thing working in our favor is because it's so cold, the dope will take 4 or 5 hours to dry, so we really don't have to rush as much as if we were working in a heated environment. Now the trick here is just damp and not wet. If you get it too wet, just go get a couple of paper towels and blot it up. The Windex, the idea of the Windex is that you don't get as much penetration because it evaporates. You don't get quite the penetration you get with water. The idea is not to get this wing any wetter than we have to. Now again, when it's cold, there's certain things you have to try to use to your advantage. Number one, as we know, if this was a hot summer day in July, this dope would be drying so fast we'd have to rush, flip this over, get onto the other side. It would be really, really labor intensive to get it right. Now I'm trying to get the dope on the whole area, but not on the cap strips. Go right up to, but not on the cap strips. Now when I sanded this out the last time I looked, it's got just a little bit of a shine on it. Now one of the advantages of doing it this way, instead of putting a wing in a body and then trying to do it, one of the advantages is I'll be able to get double tissue on the center section of the wing. And to me, that's a very important thing. That's one of the weak areas. Just look at any plane that crashes. That's usually right where it comes apart. So you know that's one of the highly stressed areas. Now we've been making plans on the phone with Joe and Bob Martens for this soon-to-be carbon I-beam wing, carbon beam wing. I don't know what we're going to call it. Joe's got some ideas, Bob Martens has some ideas, and obviously we're trying to make this a little bit nicer, better, quicker, cheaper, whatever, than the Seafire. But again, it gets difficult to make them better and better the better they get. So we're going to have a think tank day, exchange ideas, we'll videotape a little bit so you can get some idea of what we're trying to accomplish anyway. If you've been around on the videos for a long time, you know, these jobs always start out with a think tank day. You either start out with everybody agrees, or you start out with everybody doesn't agree. But we will come up with some consensus of opinion. Now see how I have the tissue over the center? Again, if it was summer, I'd really be rushing a lot more, but I know I have extra time here. Now, another thing, too, when you're making a plane where the flaps aren't attached, it's a whole lot easier, believe me. This adds another little element of difficulty, the fact that we have flaps on here. I'm going to have to work around that. None of this is impossible, but it makes it, in my estimation, it makes it a little more difficult. And it makes it a little more difficult for entry-level people to pick up. But again, if you've already picked up the basics and you're just looking at this, really for entertainment's sake, There's always some good little tips you can pick up just by watching. Now I like to get everything saturated, soaking wet, and then use my bare hands to press it down. I don't believe in fooling around trying to do it with little tiny brushes or anything. Believe me, that double tissue in the center of the wing will be a big help. Ultimately, that'll help distribute the motor vibration a lot better. Little things like that, and there's thousands of them on every model that just make it a better model without it being a lot heavier or more complex, or they make it very mediocre. Can happen either way. Okay, now I've got the trailing edge of this somewhat down. Now I'm just going to basically get in here and press down with my bare. Ooh, this is cold. Tips, of course, you know you're going to have to pull up and press down 4 or 5 times. There's a little something stuck under there. Another thing, too, is I always appreciate it's in the winter, it's cold outside, and it's good just to get together with Joe and Bob and talk about how Ken's shop is coming out. We got the okay to start moving furniture into Ken's new shop, so we'll try to get some videotape as we do that. And he's made Scotty an offer on the business. It looks like he's going to be taking over that foam wing business, so if anybody out there is looking for a foam wing, get on the first mailing list. The first train to Parksville. Now I'm just going to slit the hinge line for right now, just so I can relieve the tension here so it won't pick up. Nothing fancy. I can get rid of this piece here. Just get rid of this. I'm working on it. Now I can bend that back and press it down in the hinge line. I had a lot of people tell me the first time they ever tried using their bare hands, wow, what a great idea. And you can clean your hands with thinner or acetone or whatever, but you get a real good feel for the work. We're trying to arrange again with Al Knight for a real high-tech monocoat demo that may be coming. We just haven't been able to work out a schedule with Al yet. And he has some beautiful monocoat work. I'd love to know how he does it. I'd love to see him do it. One of the things you almost never see in Stunt News is any information on how to do real nice. And you know, the funny thing is there's an awful lot of people using monocoat. In fact, I'll tell you a little secret off the wall. Bob Barron is building a super killer, I don't know what he's going to call it, airplane with monocoat to try to win next year's Nats. He'd like to be the first guy. His goal, he said, was that like to be the first one to ever win the Nats with a monocoat plane. So again, whether you like monocoat or not is beside the point. The point is to have all the choices. Now, as I'm cutting this, I'm trying to put a little tension on it. Even though these wrinkles that are still in here will sand out. Nice, of course, if you can get as many of them out now as possible. And except for the fact that I'm uncomfortable out here and it's cold and I can't work with a jacket on, the fact that everything goes in slow motion here as far as drying goes gives you a lot more time to work out the wrinkles. Again, no substitute for a nice fresh XL blade. Now the ultimate plan here is to be working on some of the molds that we're going to have to make for this new Spitfire and bounce back and forth between the finishing of this Cardinal and the Spitfire. So there'll be an overlap time when actually we're working on both planes. And what happened, of course, with this operation, the thing we have no control over, of course, is the weather. There's a lot of times we've gone into December and had flyable weather. This year has not been one of them. This has not been a pretty year. This has been kind of snow when you didn't expect it to snow, rain when you didn't expect it to rain. Last couple of days have been terrible. I've been waiting for a day without rain. And you might be thinking, why is he waiting for a day without rain? Well, this garage leaks. The roof leaks indiscriminately, too.
And I have a couple of times already been in here working, and all of a sudden where I was working, a quart of water would fall on me. Anyway, though, we are going to try to get that shop going. Over by George's, he has an anodizing shop, which I've videotaped on many times, and he also is going to let Ken get started using that space. And we have some furniture we're making for him, some jigging. I think it's stuff you're all going to find interesting. And it'll also be nice to work along in the learning curve. Ken is going to be going up to Scotty and getting some, let's call them lessons and tricks of the trade. And I'm sure he'll share them with all of us. Even if he doesn't want to, he'll share them. He will enjoy sharing them. Anyway, okay, we got one panel done in good time. In fact, while I'm talking, you can see there's some puddles still in the garage. I'm sitting here and water started dripping on me. I had to move the table, even though it stopped raining. We're going to work on this, though. And believe me, there's another lesson to be learned. The lesson is you don't need a rocket scientist shop to build a plane. You just need some space. All right, just going to be repeating this now on the other panel. Now, because we have the parts already cut, the pieces, we can go right into the next panel without further ado. The idea is to just get going, not fool around, make a project out of anything. The main thing I'm concerned with here is getting the joint in the middle. Everything else is kind of like, I'll just pull it flush. Of course, this is the kind of a job that if Ken wasn't working, they'd have some help. Anybody, actually. Just having an extra pair of hands is very handy. That's what I like about building it in teamwork fashion. These are just a lot of jobs that are, this is one of them. Would be a lot easier. We had Banjock here, or somebody we could just chain to the silk span machine. Still haven't found any better method than just pressing it down. Now, as it starts to dry out, which is taking a lot longer than in July or down in a cellar with the heat on, it actually does give you some working time. Another way you can do it, even if you're working in a heated environment, say you're working inside in a house where you have a thermostat, put the thermostat down to 60, say. If you have it up to 70 or 80, the stuff's going to kick off so fast it'll be hard to keep up with it, but gives you a little bit extra working time. Now I'm trying to press the tissue down into the hinge line after I've slid it, of course. Again, and in every coat of dope, I'll get the machinist ruler and some 320 paper and open that seam up, press it right down with my finger. And we're not going to fool around, right over. And notice I always do the bottom first. Reason for doing the bottom first, if I'm going to get a little uncoordinated or make a few boo-boos, make them on the bottom first. Now believe me, this is, I know what it feels like to be building a stunt ship in Antarctica here. Yeah. As it's getting darker outside, it's getting colder. I remember Abe Sipra one time. I didn't have met, you know, as a kid, of course, you ask dumb questions, and I'd see Jerry Sipra's Nobler at the Nats, and I'd say, wow, how did you do that nice paint job and finish? And Harold Price would be winking at me and stuff, saying, yeah, he's not going to tell you. And he said, we paint in the winter. The dope dries slow. And maybe there was something to that, I don't know. But the Nobler is the Brodak Nobler. The finish on it is coming out outrageous. And we've painted that whole thing in Antarctica weather. In fact, the other day it snowed on poor Ken. Funny now, it wasn't funny when it happened. We were panicking. A little hit the panic button time there.
Didn't even look like snow, and all of a sudden, windy, it's snowing outside. Anyway, I'm really looking forward to getting this wing in a body soon, getting a finish on this, and at the same time be working on the plans, the molds. There's going to be some mold making involved. Again, that's another topic for Saturday. Something I'm sure we all want to have input into. And Joe is working right across, I guess across the way from the composite shop in Boeing, so maybe we could teach them how to make a 747.
I don't think so.
But on the other hand, I know they can teach me something, so I'd be a fool not to ask. I guess this is the part everybody likes to see, you know? Don't fool around, let's get it on there. I remember making a ringmaster one time and putting the tissue on and whatever, and right in the middle of doing half of it, deciding I was gonna go for a hamburger or pizza or something. And coming back with only half of the wing drying, and of course in the old days, you really weren't exactly aware of all the possibilities for warp. And looking at the wing and saying, gee, that warp wasn't there when I left. What had happened, the dope had dried on one side of the wing and not the other, and because the other side had no doping tissue. And that wing just about had a 30 degree bow in it. And if you ever want to see that in real life, take a flap, do one side of a flap, and just put it away for the day and see what happens when you come back. You'll be building in stress on one side of it. You probably could get it out if you fooled with it long enough, but why do it to begin with? Al Knight had that great little trick of making little clothespins with little lead weights on them. I guess if you were doing like nobler tips where there's a lot of ribs, maybe that would be something you wanted to try. I love block tips. I don't know what there is about block tips. It's just one of those things that can't define it, but I like the way it looks. The top, I want to wrap the silk span around, so I want to leave an extra, I guess quarter of an inch, so it wraps completely around for the joint. Down, one to go. So, you know, as the dope starts drying up, it starts to get stickier and stickier, and you can just pat it right down, right into position. I want to get that stuff down, that tissue down into the hinge line if I possibly can. Get that last panel on and get out of this ice box. But it just shows you, when you want to do something bad enough, that old saying,
if there's something you really want in life and you don't have it, what it means is you don't really want it bad enough. And if you want one of these highly finished, highly competitive, I don't know what, whatever you want to call them, super stunters, it's nothing more than just paying the price. A little bit of technique and a lot of energy. That leading edge pat down. Now I want to get right into it because this is... Just keep checking it. It really can start to warp on you in a hurry if you don't keep up with it. Again, what I'm looking for is this joint in the middle here. I want double tissue in the middle. I have to work around that push rod opening. Be surprised how many people are intimidated by tissuing jobs. They just, I don't know. I guess it's one of the things. Once you can get a little bit of a technique or watch somebody or have somebody help you, you can get right into it. And the worst that can ever happen is you pull it all off and try again. You never have to be, married to a job you don't like. You can just pull it up and get another piece of tissue. Get this out of my way. Love to do is get Doug Benedetti. He does those checkerboard silk jobs. Now I haven't done a silk job since the last time I built a voodoo, which is probably 30 years ago, but I remember silk being a real bear to work with. And it's stuff that can use that ply span, that seemed like doable stuff. I don't know how that's going to wind up in the final when we weigh it out after it's buffed and everything. It seems like it's under the weight limit now by plenty. So far, I'm trying to get some dope out onto the front of the tissue so when I trim it, it'll already have some dope drying. Now that'll be one thing on an I-beam Spitfire to have to work around the tissue. That'll definitely be a two-man job because the edges will be so small. Again, if you have any ideas, any feedback, thoughts, ideas on these planes, give it to me. Right now is a good time while I can still use it. Got a lot of ideas. I have that picture in my head now of what this plane is going to look like. I have thought of, and Joe Adamusco has confirmed with me, we should be making a Reno Air Race Spitfire. I'm looking for pictures of that plane called the G-Fire, that red. It's a red late model Spit. Time will tell, and you always come up with new ideas. Now, that's just another thing. Joe Adamusco, new ideas. Always having ideas. And being around Boeing, you can't help but have ideas. So many people contributed to that original Spitfire project. Must have set some kind of record. Boy, I sure miss working in a warm place. Woo! It's cold out here. It's dope when you touch it. It's like putting your hand in a cold fish tank. Now, if you go over, good tip, if you go over and we flip this over and you see the other side is already bone dry, you might want to wet both sides at the same time. Just go and put one big, thick, wet coat of dope on both sides so they both start to dry at the same time. That's what we're always ultimately trying for, is that the both sides are shrinking at the same time. And so many people build a beautiful wing, it's perfectly straight when you take it off the jig. You take it off the jig, you dope it, you put the first coat of dope on it, you put the tissue on,
still straight. As soon as you get the tissue dried out and you start this, go to Pretzelville.
Now, because this took a little longer than I thought, and I see one side is starting to dry up already, I'm going to go over the whole wing and get the whole wing, except for the part that's open bay, good and wet. And this way it'll all tend to dry. Tend to dry is the right word, not guaranteed. Seems like not many things in the world of model aviation are guaranteed, and this is one of them. But and we'll put this aside for at least a day. Come back out to here tomorrow. And this way there's absolutely no dope in the house. My wife stays happy. Her asthma stays at its minimum inconvenience to us. And actually it makes me a tough guy to sit out here in a garage and freeze like an Eskimo. I'm sure Steve DeJulia's going, ha ha, just freeze, Artnowski. And you're right, Steve, I am freezing. Anyway, it's worth it. Anyway, we are trying to improvise and share the way we're improvising. I'm sure there's other people that have to work under worse conditions. No sense being a crybaby. But now, see, once I get that one side done, I want to flip it over and get the other side right away. This side kind of dried up. Actually, it dried up faster than I thought it would. And that's the whole thing, is no matter how you do it, is get both sides drying at the same time. And then you run the minimum risk that you're going to wind up in some way putting a warp or some inaccuracy into a wing that you spend all that time getting it nice and trued up and level. And I guess that is one of the good tricks. That's one of the tricks years ago nobody really shared with you. They didn't share anything, in fact. Very few people would really come out and tell you everything. Or anything, really. Go back, think about it. Anyway, that's not the case now. Anybody that really is intense and wants to do a really nice finish or build a really nice model, the information is available for the asking. Or the watching, or whatever you want to call it. Now remember, the object here is to make all the edges attached to the wood. This open bay has no dope on it. When I put the shrink dope on, I'm going to put two coats of shrink dope over the open bays. I want this to be well attached. If I rush that and do that before this is really dry, it'll just pull on the outside perimeter here and not be as effective as I want it to be. I really want it to be battened down real nice. In fact, I usually wait till at least the minimum the next day to put any dope on the tissue. Now when I go over the tissue, I'll go out onto the wood, and when I do the wood, I'll go out onto here. I only want to have shrink dope on the open bays. I don't want any shrink dope anywhere else. And it's a good idea to really mark your jars. We were marking the jar when, I think last time we were doing a spit, Joe brought just enough, and then I get it out of the shop, because if you use it by mistake somewhere else on the plane, you are going to Pretzel City. That stuff just never stops shrinking. We'll get right up to that area, but not beyond it. And I've got everything wet, and it's just about time to put this away. Whole thing wet. We're going to put it aside, get inside, and do the mail. In today's mail, got a nice picture from Charles Lickley. And this is his Miss Dara. And he says it's finally starting to look like an airplane. Now I'm just looking at this and wondering what the turtle deck looks like. It says an awful big rake on a turtle deck. Anyway, I'm not familiar with the design, but anyway, looks real nice. And I'm just looking at his, as always, looking at the building table. By the way, I did have some pictures one time of this giant typhoon. He's still got that in the background. Finish it! Just looking around, always looking around for some ideas you can use. I see he's got a nice piece of heavy glass here. He's got the same machinist ruler. It looks like the same one I have. Oh, it looks like he's building in a garage. This looks like a garage door. Anyway, Always looking, especially with Ken getting ready to set up that shop, always looking for more ideas. Now this is a really nice picture. Notice, look at this. Check it out. It's a Christmas card. Hey, I like it. I gotta think about doing this some year. That's a nice idea. Ray and Becky Firkins. Looks like they have a skylark. They're from California. Look, they're freezing. I'm freezing out in the garage tissueing, and you guys are sunbathing. Give me a break. Anyway, thanks a lot. Appreciate it. One of the things I've been looking at in one of my... I don't even know which catalog this is. This is Northern. Northern. Anyway, looking at a lot of nice, useful things in here, but one of the things that has caught my eye here, and I've been thinking about this as one of the things I'd like to get for Christmas from Karen, these organizers for all the screws and nuts and bolts and blind nuts. This would be an excellent thing. Now, the only problem is I've seen these in Home Depot, and they're much larger, where they have like 100 shelves, so these look a little bit smaller. But anyway, it's always good to compare prices. Now, see, this is another nice little thing. It's a revolving tray. All these little things, they all add up. It's just unbelievable how many nice little things there are. Years ago, I don't remember there being this many nice things. Also, another thing they have here, and it's not out of the question to invest in one of these things, is a laser light pointer to make a wing leveler out of. Again, so many ideas. These are the kind of things, whenever Joe and Adam Usko and I are around, all kind of compressor fittings, fancy little things, hoses. You never have too many of these catalogs. These things are always worth having. And this one in particular comes from, you want to copy the address. And believe me, you call these people up, they'll send them to you for free. Get on their mailing list, and then you get this endless supply of stuff to fish through and look for prices. Now, John Brodak sent this down here. This is an XL Hobby Blades self-healing mat. Now, George has one of these. George bought one of these, and he was showing me, this is something I never had in a shop. What you do, it saves the blades. When you cut on top of it, you make intricate little cuts. What happens is, you don't wear out the tip of the blade as quickly as if you're cutting on glass or even newspaper or whatever, but this is something, being we're gonna have to cut out a set of ribs real soon. Now what happens, see, it goes right through, but it goes into a self-healing rubber. They call it a self-healing mat. When you're done, you can't feel where the knife mark is. Again, this is something I'm going to be using in the future, especially on this upcoming Spitfire project. So I really feel like this is something, especially for cutting ribs, this would really be handy to have. Again, from XL, I got this right from John Brodak. This looks like one of those tools that once you have it, you kind of wonder how you ever got along without it. Now this came from Brian McCarthy, and Brian McCarthy's in Colorado, and he's been building, I guess, still working on his Cardinal kit, but he knows that we're going to be doing up a Spitfire, and he sent this in. We've had this in magazine in the past, I believe. I think Joe originally got it, and it has some really nice, inspirational kind of stuff, and again, it's always looking for the details. It's the details. This is one of the things, the old zebra stripes. Just some things to give you some ideas. Now this is a little, I have to read this yet. This is some stuff called A Bomber's Tale by Brian McCarthy. And he sent this along with the magazine. So more nice little stuff, but basically getting inspired. And it's always, at least for me anyway, having these magazines around is like, I don't know, like drugs. You just start looking at them, and the first thing you want to do is start building something. You want to start inventing something. You want to start molding something. I don't know what it is. These books have a, I don't know, like a magic potion. Now, one of the things this one had was one picture of all of the 50 still flyable, survivable Spitfires. And I've been looking for an exotic paint job. I don't really care for the silver and red guy, but there's some other ones in here. A lot of them are in color. That are really, really nice. Again, this is what you need to get going. You need that inspiration. You need some five, there's some more pictures of the stuff. some five-bladed prop pictures to get you motivated. It's one I never even considered is the all-white one. There's an all-white version. Again, this is for the Burmese Air Force. Again, doesn't mean you have to make a British version. And being we're even considering Reno Air Race versions, here's an American version up here. Oh, there's just so many things. It's just hard. When you get involved in Spitfires, it's hard not to like them. Those five-bladed props. Now talk about an exotic paint job for a clip wing. Look at this guy. Look at this, President Nixon's back. Can't even read my magazines. Again, anybody out there that still has some of my books on loan, I'd appreciate you sending them back or getting ready to be inspired here. And we know there's about 20 of them out on loan right now. Some beautiful books, and even the one from Uwe Degner. I don't even know what that one is. Thought Midgley had that, but I guess he doesn't. That stripes around the spinner look so nice. Would even look good on a normal snunner. Some pictures of the contra-rotating late model Seafires with the folding wings. Look at that prop. Oh, man. Again, kind of an unusual paint job, but not one that really inspires me. Some of the Warbird art in these magazines is so good. There's one in American Mark. That's something I never even thought of, doing one in American markings. Hey, Joe, come up with... See, it's ideas. This is the thing. Just by flipping through these magazines, you get ideas. This is a picture of Joe Adamusco's cellar. Holy mackerel, look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 Spitfires. Pretty nasty looking paint jobs there. Anyway, more stuff to think about, more stuff to dream about. Back to the shop.
Okay, right. We got the three amigos here.
The three amigos. One sitting on his ass and two working.
Excuse me.
Anyway, this is now officially the beginning of the 1998 carbon I-beam, and we'll try to carry you through a little bit of what we're doing here. This is the work. Joe had already prototyped up a set of ribs, half ribs. We've got this on the plans already. Bob Martens, what shall we call you? Aircraft engineer supreme?
Just
designed major parts of the Beach Starship.
Well, I worked on that.
Didn't know he was designing. I thought he was making a Spitfire. Anyway, what they've done here is lay out the ribs on tape. What we're going to try to do is make a quarter quadrant of an I-beam elliptical. I don't even know what we have to call this yet. We've been making little drawings and prototype drawings. And I thought everybody that subscribes to the tapes would enjoy seeing just how much work goes into making an accurate set. It isn't something that just jumps off the drawing board. You have to have things like French curves and French women. And look at these things, man.
Those are
if I knew you had this much money, I would have let you pay for breakfast. Holy mackerel.
These are Copenhagen ship's curves.
Okay. I mean, this is professional stuff. This is not Willy Wonka stuff.
When we were on, did work on the drawing boards, that was the...
Okay. We can put the Argus plans away. We laid out Argus plans to see what the rib spacing was. It's an inch, and that's basically what we're going to use. Where are those Argus plans, Joe?
I rolled them up there.
Okay. Just throw those back in a tube can so we don't have a bunch of trash here. Now, what you're trying to do is figure out an eighth-inch spacing.
Tape is not the...
And tape isn't going to do it?
We don't have to go full rib anyway. We just have to come back to
Okay.
Somewhere in here.
Let me see what we have better tape than this. Use this tape, and I have Pilot pens that'll make a real, that'll stick, a real accurate. We want to make the equivalent of an eighth-inch cap on all of these half ribs. Now, because Joe works at Boeing.
Hey, don't forget Bob. Bob's a Boeing guy now, too.
Yeah, what were you, a Piper guy, and then you became a Boeing? You're like a turncoat, aren't you?
I go where
And
they,
Ken, we don't know what the hell he's doing, stealing Scott Smith technology.
I know where they...
He has a rich girlfriend. Best of all worlds.
I go where the money is, usually.
Yeah. I usually go where the money isn't. Anyway, he's laying out, because what we want to do is plot the spar. The first part of this project is to plot the spar. And this is the kind of stuff that has to be done absolutely dead accurate. You can see how accurate Joe has.
See what I'm doing? This tape works.
These plans.
You want me to do some of these?
We don't have to go. If we went back as far as the second rod hole.
Do the whole thing, Joe. Just.
Want to do the whole thing?
The reason I say is, let's take a Pilot pen. Ken is real good at doing this too. And then trace that, have the tape and the line at the same time. Kenny, those Pilot pens, those real thin writing things. Oh, we got one up here.
I'd feel better.
Just look at this. I just made
this up. I never saw a real draftsman work. This is pretty cool. He even has a dictionary. Don't bring that in my cellar.
This is just how I store stuff so it stays all together and doesn't get lost.
Well, you know, part of this is a lot of people think you draw a set of plans or you do something. It's just some casual thing. You just sit down and say, yeah, the rudder will look good here and a wing tip. No. Now, when you're doing a Spitfire... Mitchell worked this way.
Rigid.
We have a whole bunch of hamsters running around in the wheel here this morning. Nobody wants to pay for breakfast. And George isn't even here yet. Oh my God, this is going to be great. Okay. And as if this wasn't enough, we even have Ernie swimming upside down today to keep us company.
Poor little creature.
Poor Ernie. He's back to swimming upside down.
Poor Ernie. If I could live free for swimming upside down, yeah.
We'll feed you peas in the morning,
show
too.
Show me the water.
Show me the water. Show me the money.
Yeah, show me the money. Bring out the loot.
About 1/4 of the quadrant here, I see.
1/4 of the spar.
Okay. Now, I got an idea if you want to try. I have yardsticks. Spruce yardsticks that don't bend and bow and twist like balsa wood does. Should we make a 1/4 quadrant template out of the spruce?
Yeah.
I mean, because then if we screw it up, I got plenty of yardsticks.
Well, you do a template, then you just glue this
right.
Piece, so I'll do the template.
Contact cement that down, and I'll take it out and cut it with the saw.
Yeah, and finish it so it's...
Boy, it's nice to watch a professional work.
That's what I was thinking when we were working on your house.
Yeah, thank God we have tenants again. after 5 days of Ken scraping wallpaper, I'll tell you, Kenny, as long as there's people with wallpaper that need to be removed, we'll have a job.
Oh,
thanks. Oh, man.
That's a kind of a thankless
task.
That's
a future I want to look forward to.
Decided this think tank episode here that we have all these yardsticks. These are spruce, and what happens with spruce is, years ago when I was making the sweeper, I made the I-beam out of yardsticks. This is what I made it out of. And these are really nice. They stay nice and straight with humidity changes. So we're going to try to make a template out of one of these. So I'll sight down all these. Some are a little straighter than others, but I'll sight the straightest one out. You can see how many I've already used here. And these, I found a yard sale up in Massachusetts where they were selling these for 10 cents a piece. So I really should have bought 100 of them. You could use them for firewood even for 10 cents a piece. You know? Heat your house with yardsticks. How are you doing? You got the ribs?
Yeah,
oh, look at this.
They're
what a guy.
There.
Yeah, that really adds the... he's got a compass. Boy, the last compass I had, I was in school. Oh, man. Okay. The deal is here, you sharpen the pencil point?
Yeah, with a piece of sandpaper, and
okay.
It gives a constant wide line
right.
Width instead of having a regular point get dull on you and the line weight goes all to...
Okay, yeah, that's a good idea. Because as the thing is wearing, it's getting wider and wider,
yeah,
too.
These should be fairly parallel.
Okay.
Just a little...
That's a good little tip if you're doing drawings, draftings and stuff.
Yeah.
There's a 25% airfoil, so we would hope that you could get the spar At the 25% mark. Okay. So just figure this out. And I see Joe has the hole cut for the rod. Go 25%.
Okay.
And we'd like to be, see, because as this tapers out, here's one of the problems. As it tapers out, we don't want to have it coming out the leading edge of the wing. I'm guessing it should be back a half to three quarters of an inch further back from the front rod hole. And a front rod hole isn't hurting anything. We can just leave it there.
Ken, you want to give me what you have done? I'll scribe the incline on that.
Oh, you're going like crazy here.
I mean, this is...
What a production, I'm telling you. Hitler would be in trouble if we were making real Spitfires. We'd be able to make one every 15 years, you know. Bob, this side is the truer of the two sides here. I trued this up now. I'm going off the ruler here, and I know this ruler is dead true. This one is real good here. So, Mark somehow put a little X or something that this is going to be the quadrant edge right here. Okay, that's what we want to work off. And I would work off the middle of the piece, not the end. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Does that sound like the right way to do it?
Yeah, this would be okay. The center.
We'll try to center. Yeah, that side is perfectly straight. The other one's got about a 64th of an inch bow in it.
Yeah, it's a little wobbly.
That one is not perfect. And it is. They're not cut straight. See how much we have here?
We got a bow in the center of it. Yeah, this would be nice.
And this side is perfect. Okay, so we want to start with that pattern being as accurate as possible. Now, do you want to trace the line? You want to just cut the paper and glue it to this? Is that how you want
to
do this?
Yeah, that'd be the way to do it.
And then we can just flip-flop it?
Trim to that with the saw and then sand to the line or take
it. I'll sand to the line with the belt sander.
Yeah, and we'll, as soon as I get this, get these cords on here, then I can draw this curve in and we can cut this out.
Great, okay.
Throw it down for you.
Now, another thing we could do while you have these good, the ship's curves, If we could take a half inch block or a 1 inch block and just make this angle, this exact curve. Now what I can use is if I do decide to mold this piece, I can wet it with ammonia and use this as a mold.
Just put something on top of this and trace another curve.
Right.
Is that what you want?
I want to have this curve come right out to the tip and disappear too.
Oh.
I don't want to have it end at the last rib if possible.
Okay. Just extend the curve.
You let it go right out to the tip and disappear into, you know, where it gets carved in.
Okay, let me get in there.
Joe, what percentage is this airfoil?
It should be a 25. Is it 25?
Excuse me. You're asking me.
No, I'm asking you. You stole it. I didn't steal it. When I steal it, I usually know what I'm stealing.
It's a French curve special.
Okay. Next step is you want to lay this out so it comes around and it maintains this exact half-inch curve around the whole perimeter. Now, the reason for doing that, Bob, is I want to be able to have the adjustable lead-out. If we made this the way you said, with like a laminate, what's going to happen is right where the lead-outs are going to come out, you're going to lose all the integrity.
You're going to have some problems.
That'll be a problem by doing it that way.
Okay, so we want to go...
A half-inch. I'm guessing a half-inch material will give you enough to attach the tissue and then make a nice blend down a razor edge. And I also thought about making the whole back outline at a dollhouse wood, you know, a piece of
basswood or
16th basswood, so you can't, you know, you just ding it every time you touch it.
Well,
and then you can carve into the basswood, use it for a nice razor edge.
Yeah, that's
just a thought, one of the thoughts of doing this. This is why it's nice when you have four guys that all don't know what they're doing at the same time. Look at these curves. Oh man, I'd be going crazy now. You don't remember when I was making that Spitfire rudder the first time? Oh my god.
I saw that.
It took 4 hours to make a rudder because I didn't have a French curve.
That's not
weird. So nice when you have tools, boy. Tools are the whole deal.
It's even nicer when you know how to use them.
Yeah. It's even nicer when you have somebody else do the work and you stand around taking full credit for everything. All right. And too, while we're here, is we're fine-tuning this. Bob's going to make up a real final drawing for John Brodak.
Is it thicker here than it is
here? I want to add that this is a 2-inch spinner. See, this was the original thing. Is if you need to work, you know, you need to get this 2 inches, and just add enough material so it blends right into the canopy on a final drawing.
Excuse me, I got that done incorrectly.
Again, we'll be able to submit this to John and hopefully have a real nice accurate drawing for him to work off when he cuts the kit.
Okay, and then we'll put.
Right. You have enough mylar that you can make a final drawing on this?
Yeah.
Okay. In good shape. I mean, he just needs to use it to cut kit parts out of it. It doesn't have to be like all the lettering and everything.
No. So this line extends right through.
Oh, it does extend through.
All right. That's the only thing that.
Okay. Now you're plotting the high point of the wing.
Yeah, but look at it.
Okay.
There's your, where your rib holes would be. This is not going to, the high point is not going to be a straight line. So this is where maybe the spar has to be. We're gonna stick these back up vertically.
Okay, and see where it winds up. You know, you're not going to be able to make a V spar, though. We may have to compromise and take the midpoint and go back and forth.
You ain't wrong, compromise. Okay, we're going to reverse the tape there.
Yeah. Okay, let's reverse it.
Stick them up vertically again.
Okay. Oh, Spencer, I'm telling you, that's Santa Claus Adamusco over there.
I watched Wendy tape and, pull it. And I did it the same way. I said, well, wait, there's going
to
be.
You got to have it. Hey, and when you're doing foam wings, you need that tape dispenser. Like, forget it.
Either that or a third hand.
Okay. Well, that one might not work out.
These guys are doing this the hard way.
Wait a minute, Bob. We got to, if you're going to.
Take one long piece.
It'll wiggle-waggle. We want to do it in segments. But we want to span this so that we get mid-bay with this balled-up piece of tape, okay?
You don't realize this is what these guys do for a living. This is why I make them do it for me.
And, like, maybe just drop it back.
Yeah.
No, over
Stagger
here.
Stagger it.
That's... Nope.
These guys don't argue the way we do.
No, I know. You know what the difference
we
is?
We haven't been...
They're educated.
They're enough to argue yet.
They have college degrees and we dropped out of kindergarten.
Well, I don't know anybody well enough here to do that.
I can see Steve DiGiulio now going, fire all these guys from Pennsylvania.
No cussing, huh?
No cussing.
No cussing.
Okay, yeah, no. Guys see a set of Spitfire plans and they think, oh, he just did that in a half an hour.
Right, Scotty, you betcha.
Sure, beam me up, Scotty. This is labor intensive even for guys that know what they're doing.
You want to peel the tape off of those, Ken? All right. R1.
Hey Joe, keep in mind, I want to make the fuselage more scale-like and wider, so that center section need not be even taken into consideration yet.
See, there's going to be more than one R1 here. Wait a minute, where's my brain? Okay, there's R2.
You need your cheaters?
Not yet.
Okay.
Wendy want a lot of ribs?
I want ribs. If you're going to go to the moon, you may as well not stop off at the cloud. Go to the moon.
You use contest balsa for these things. I can't believe it.
That's all the kind of balsa I am.
Can I come and work in your shop?
That's to avoid cutting his leg again when he was in the car.
Yeah.
Turned his leg into a rib with a razor blade.
When I was cutting ribs for the original Spitfire wings, I made so many R1s. The wing would have been like 84 inches long. So I used up a lot of my spare ribs.
Now, when you did the ship curve, did you put the curve into that last little bit?
Yeah.
Oh. Okay. I didn't know if you did or not.
This one and this wing here, I'll have to get a curve on it to see. That can be trimmed up.
I mean, while you have those good French curves, curves or whatever you call
them. I've got the Seafire plans. We took the curve out of the Seafire plan, or the straight section out of the Seafire plans.
In other words, here's the whole deal, is I don't want to change the displacement of the wing by much.
And that changed the outline of the wing on an order of 1/8 of an inch, so...
An eighth, yeah.
But there are those discerning individuals that can see that much.
Oh, I can see it. You know why? Because the invasion stripes come right in at 90 degrees. You know, another thing, when we plot out the tail again, I got your drawing for the tail. I was thinking of another thing I want to try on the tail to make the tail a lot more scale-like. I'll get into that when we finish this rib thing.
Yeah, I've got some notions about flap and...
And this and wing has a little bit... It has the hinge line move forward 1/4 inch, too, right?
Yeah,
this is the
flap's bigger.
Okay, bigger flaps, so we can move them less.
That's why we went to...
Bigger flaps, move them less. This plane is going to wind up with 4 to 5 controls, I'm sure, but we'll make it adjustable just in case. And that's proven to be a good thing, by the way, on both of those.
Yeah, what hole are you in on your new one?
The closest one.
The closest one to the elevator, the top hole.
Right, so that hinge line needs to get moved forward just a little bit too, another quarter of an inch.
The top hole.
The top hole, the one closest to the pivot point.
The shorter throw.
You got, what we're doing is compromising the high point here. We're working off the front of the yardstick.
The high point was like this when the spar was sweeping back this way, so we decided to...
We want to have the spar a completely straight line.
A planer spar instead of something with a joint here.
No joint, no, definitely no joint. Well, now we need to plot out the height for that whole quadrant.
Right,
which is easy to just pick up from the red dot down to the base of the...
And just go with a red dot with a 90-degree triangle, and that'll give you...
Yeah, Wendy's gadget here is just fine.
Oh, yeah, the gadget is great for
this. This one here.
So you see how that would be? You'd have a lot of half rib in the front of your facets.
Yeah, that's okay. Picking up the red dot and just running a red line down.
And this is laying flat.
Okay.
Then we can lay out this distance from here to here.
Right.
At the stations here and arrive.
And we can run each station.
Curve.
Right.
And the curve is not going to be, you'll hardly be able to notice the elliptical curve. It'll just drop off slightly.
But having the curve makes it a lot more rigid than a straight line.
Okay,
a straight line is...
When you get the curve on there, we'll put a straight edge against it and you'll see.
Yeah, right.
It won't be much, but it'll be something. It increases the air difficulty.
It'll be the only plane I know of that has a curved
spar,
elliptical, 2,000 rib. Oh man, rocket science!
It's going to be interesting.
This is going to be fun. This is the fun of model aviation right here.
You're not going to monocoat it though.
No. And this will be hand buffed. This will have the. I've been thinking Reno Air Race paint job.
Well,
I can't get that out. Speaking
of
that, look at the TV. Reno Air Race paint job. Look at this. Reno, that's what we need.
You're trying to paint tape rondelles on all these little facets.
I'm thinking G-Fire.
If anyone can do it, we know someone who...
G-Fire!
You can't paint it white and you don't have a hair on your hiney unless you paint a candy apple red.
No, it's red, but it's not candy apple red. Oh. That G-Fire, I can't get pictures of that G-Fire, though. The only picture we have is that one in George's book.
It's
a Reno Air Race Spitfire.
I saw that on a calendar.
Yeah, it's got the spinner with the star painted on the front of the spinner.
But, Wendy, I think if you started sketching around, you can come up with a more creative flash.
Oh, maybe, yeah. There's no reason this has to be scale either. We can make this the Atomusco soon-to-be fantasy air racer.
I'm going to have...
Okay, you're making an accurate measurement off the compass of the height at each rib station.
Right, then I'm taking this, I'm transferring it to the...
Down to what amounts to be the drawing.
Right, this is the center line of the spar.
Okay.
And then this is going to be the contour. I'll just connect the dots with one of these ship's curves.
Okay. Now, even if you were to do this with dots and straight lines and then blend it in, it would be a lot better than just doing a straight line. Joe, can you get the door for Kenny? It sounds like he's coming in with an oblong.
Well, yeah, I think a curve, the curve is... makes the thing done.
The curve, as far as I'm concerned, is the whole trick here is to add the strength from the curve. Whoa! Put it up on a bar there for a while.
Oh dear.
Are you gonna?
That's the first time I've seen it with the tissue. We had the.
You gonna paint over the silver, Ken?
He's got candy maroon.
All right.
Candy maroon.
Candy apple maroon.
Let me show you this candy color.
Oh my God! Look at this thing.
This
it looks great.
This is the one that you built on a video.
This is the one you the video
this
one.
This is the
fiberglass
you pulled out of
fiberglass cowl.
Ken, is this the one you pulled out of mothballs?
No, this is a Brodak kit.
Oh, this is a brand new one.
Brodak kit from scratch.
Oh, okay.
This one's so good that that other one probably will never be completed.
Oh yeah, got to finish it.
You didn't bring that paint that you have for this model, did you?
Yeah, it's here.
Ooh, I like it.
Boy, this dried up nice. Ooh. Yeah, the canopy's nice. The silver is real nice on it. He did a lot of work getting the silver detailed.
Outstanding.
Yeah, very nicely done.
I just want you to be able to see.
Jerry Cipra would be proud.
Oh, he's smoking and.
Yeah. This really looks nice in the sun. This is that fly span. We got to figure out how we're going to trim this with some pretty exotic looking paint here yet, but
ink lines.
Do those three or four little
pinstripes, and they all have to come to a point back here. And it's going to be exotic, yeah. It'll be real nice when it's done.
Oh my! Hey, it's going to break your arm, this airplane.
Did you weigh it?
Nah,
it's probably getting up in the high 30s already with all that paint on it.
Flying off too heavy.
You better give it to Adam Usko.
Well, we can work out a trace or something.
Thanks.
Yeah, that's really coming out nice.
I've built enough of those to know, man.
Yeah. It's hard not to like Noblers. They really... I don't know. This seems like he's gonna have one beautiful plane here when this is finished. City.
Yeah.
Bob is accurately measuring to the millionth of an inch.
These are growing just a little bit.
If you decide you want
to
do.
But you only need to do one quadrant of this. You don't need to lay out the whole square.
Yeah. That's
this one.
Because once I make the mold, if that's the way we're going to do it, once the mold is made, I can make these over and over and over and over, and it'd be just like making those five-bladed props. It'll be a piece of cake.
I don't think
yeah, right.
It'll be so labor-intensive you want to kill somebody.
That's right.
This stuff is all easy once the mold is made. You notice that?
If I'm going to build an airplane...
I mean, once the mold is made, everybody says, oh, yeah, that's easy. Sure.
Nothing to that.
Once this is all laid out...
What's the big problem?
People buy a set of plans and they think, this guy drew these plans in 15 minutes. They don't know you put 150 hours into the plans.
Hello, 15 minutes.
Oh, yeah, hello.
Hey, you're going to join us to fly this?
Anyway, by doing each one, we'll ultimately wind up with a quadrant, one quarter of the spar, as accurate as humanly or subhumanly possible.
Subhumanly possible.
Or post-humanly possible. And then we'll make an accurate replication of that onto the piece of spruce. Make sure we have... You know, I'm just wondering, Bob, if we... we're going to glue this right to the wood?
Yeah.
And cut it all at once. Okay, that's what I was thinking we should do.
Otherwise, we're not going to get where we need to be.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
It just... The whole...
Now from this point on, you need the ship's curve.
Yeah. Actually,
I keep it hanging up on the wall
The middle part is pretty. I guess there's six, eight ribs that are all tended or all the same.
I want some kind of little figure over here, or even just a scallop. And I want a streak of yellow that goes straight down the fuselage.
Not exactly the same as making plans on the back of paper bags like in the old days, huh?
Let's see if this is how it is.
Well, yeah, that served the purpose for that time. But this looks like it's probably...
I think this is going to work fine. I'm getting the feeling this is going to be real good.
Okay, I'll put
now you got...
Put a good line on this for you. We have a straight section from center line out to about to here.
And then it goes ship's curve down.
Then we got a curve there, which is kind of what we expected.
Are you just going to overcut it to start with?
Yeah.
That's the quadrant.
Oh. Yeah, and the yellow swoop down.
Well, let's make sure you marked which edge is the good edge.
That's the good edge right there.
Is it thick enough? Geez, I didn't even think of that before. Another great engineering feat. It's just thick enough. Holy crow. It's like it was made for that.
Okay, I'll let you...
I'll get the contact cement for that.
Yeah.
All right, let me see what you did there.
But this is stuff that we have. It's spray contact cement, and it does melt foam. But it'll be good for attaching this, what I hope is a super accurate template, attached to the good side of the yardstick. And I'll do that outside. We're going to go out and put some dope on that cardinal wing now. See how that's drying up.
Yeah.
And this has a glass cowl.
It's the number one glass cowl in the world right there, in fact. Watch it roll off the bar while we're outside. He needs to learn how to repair holes in the tissue anyway, so give him a few to start with.
No, that's not right. That's nicely done.
I got to admit, even I like that. If I had the money to go to VSC, hey, I'd be there.
If you were willing to spend the money to go
I'm
to
too
VSC.
Cheap.
Too cheap.
Okay. How about if we spend your money?
Yeah.
That's what I like. Hey, nice and warm working out here, huh?
Yeah, right.
See shivering going on out there? Whoa. Anyway, we're starting to get some coats of clear on this in between making up our spar. Everybody likes working out in these primitive conditions here. Kind of make like the Green Bay Packers of dope finishing here.
We're a real man.
It only takes like 3 minutes to clear.
Anyway, while that's working, I got the spar down here on the floor. I put some contact cement on it, kind of letting that kick off. Oh, it smells so good out here. Karen, you don't know what you're missing. Press it all down.
You know, twin tails and all that stuff.
And once that dries, we'll put it down by a heating vent. It's not going to dry out here at 20 below zero.
It's a little bit frosty.
Yeah, frosty to snowman.
Yeah, I think we got it all right.
Yeah, I think that's fine. We'll put that by the heating vent, and then we can cut it. Now we're back in where it's nice and warm. He's just rolling it with a kicker bottle to get that pattern down onto the...
So it doesn't come loose while you're cutting.
Yeah, for sure. Then we can cut that with a nice new XL blade and bingo. There's plenty of glue on that. I don't think that'll be coming off.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
Go right through that spruce or whatever it is. Fantastic.
Nice wood.
All right, this we'll cut with the saw. Ken's got some... Wait a minute, let's go right to the end of the table. So we have... Go try to start at the end of the table and go, you know...
Yeah, you've used this stuff before.
Yep.
Has this got the sticky on it?
It's already got the sticky stuff on it.
It used to have sticky on it.
Well, tape both edges if it isn't sticky enough.
Adhesive is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. You can put tape around the edges. You're only going to use the middle anyway. Of course, this glue is old. This is old sandpaper I've had for a while. We can just, you can run the masking tape down the whole end, Ken. Don't even think about it.
We're only going to use the center, so this will do it. It'll be fine.
We're going to use this for the whole building of the plane, so run it for the whole length of the table. Okay. You know, we can true up our 48-inch pieces. We're going to true up the spar, the side pieces. We're not in the business of saving tape. I don't care how much tape I have to buy.
I thought we were going to take it up right away.
No, it's going to be on here for the life of the plane. Because we're going to build a wing off of this side of the table. We don't have to worry. Anything you like there, Joe? How many of those you got by your house? Tell me the truth.
Two?
I got three, huh? Not really. Ken's doing is using a sanding block to hold it 90 degrees to the work surface. And what that does, we got this long piece of sandpaper taped to the table. All you're using that block for is to maintain a 90 degrees. And we've kind of agreed that the thickness at the caps is going to be 1/4 inch, so the next step is to cut the 1/4 inch notch in all the ribs. Looks good? Let's see what that looks like.
Looking pretty good.
Okay. Yeah, that sanding block should be really good. Yeah, you've got the curve in one side, and one side should be really straight. We don't care about this side-to-side stuff. Not right now.
Well, I'm going to knock the edge off now.
Okay. Yeah, just dress the edge off and we'll lay out I'll vacuum that up right away and then we'll lay out the rib notches. Pictures in there, huh?
Yeah, you've got some pictures of the plans here.
Yeah, well, you should know, my guy.
Yeah, I can see that.
Take some pictures if you want. Hey, this is all from the project when Joe and I worked up the thing for the magazine.
This is a cow development. You documented.
Yeah, canopy development. Look at all this stuff. Bro, we really know our stuff. We got somebody fooled anyway. But I don't know. Hey, wait, there's a picture of somebody's wife in a nude. What's going on here? Recognize anybody, Joe?
You've been busy. Ah,
stealing all my good pictures here. Each station, we've got 1/8 of an inch of clear. I can't imagine that the tissue is going to bow more than 1/8 of an inch. I think that's a reasonable amount. But to get this cut, now we'd like to take 1/4 inch tape, take this off, and run it along. You want to use the front edge or the back edge?
Whatever. You can Maybe.
Now, from looking at this, I see a problem we didn't envision. The landing gear are going to be too far back. So we can't use these for the gear block. We're going to have to make gear blocks that attach to this.
You have to build a torque box like you built.
Exactly. I'll have to come up with like a piece of plywood or something, but that's not a problem.
Yep.
This, as long as we don't disturb the spar, we actually can use the front of this now. Lay the quarter inch tape on this side and then cut all the pieces. You know, it's going to get weak up at the top. That's another problem.
Those are going to break.
Well, right now, there's no other. We don't have plywood templates yet. You know, for right now, I'd have to lay each one out individually and cut it with plywood. But for right now, I think that'll do.
The start.
And we got all the stations marked on that piece.
Yep. Yeah, this is the center line.
Thinking we can take another eighth inch off the whole length of the spar. Is that your feeling?
Yeah. And you still have plenty of material.
And we still have plenty, and you have more material around the top of the ribs that the spar isn't going to hit.
Yeah.
All at the same time.
Yeah, because you're going to have, this is going to be an over an inch thick as it is, or 3/4 inch.
Out at the tip. And how about up there? It's over 2 inches up there.
We've got an inch and 1/16 here, or an inch and 3/32. And then put it...
You're going to be just under 2 inches for the spar.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's take an eighth of an inch off the whole length before we cut the rib notches. Get the eighth inch tape.
Yeah, just...
Now, I think I know a good way to do this. Lay out the eighth inch tape on the curve. No, lay it out on a curved edge. Well, we don't care. Yeah, we don't care. We're taking it off the whole thing.
We want to take it off the straight.
Okay.
Edge.
Yeah, then you can sand that.
It's like using, just like when you make a hinge line, you laid out the first piece of tape for a reference.
This tape curves too.
Put the yellow tape on, and then we'll double check it with the straight ruler for sure. In fact, we'll cut this with the straight ruler, with the real good straight edge, rather than trying to saw it.
Yeah.
Get a brand new blade and just run it. I just pull that up, and we will have, in effect, 1/4 inch less spar thickness here.
You made me get rid of my fingernails.
Got them. You get rid of the fingernails when you're sanding silver, my friend.
Yeah, see? I came prepared.
You can always tell a guy that doesn't know to do good finish, get jewelry and watches and everything on. Okay. All right, now if we get a straight edge and a brand new blade, I think we can slice that. Get somebody to hold it. And another ruler to block this up so the straight edge stays perfectly straight right down the whole length while we're cutting. Okay, you're ready. Let's get it lined up. Even if you leave a little bit extra on, let me hold it here. Get it lined up. I'll use the pressure. You might want to score it one cut and then cut hard. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay.
Give it a score cut, just like sheetrock, and then cut it 3 or 4 times. By the way, the spruce does cut pretty nice. This is the spar material that's actually in the big sweeper. Amazing. Just you'll get the best shot, and all you'll have to do is true it up.
We'll see if some yellow tape comes up with this.
Yeah, you're coming down to the home stretch now. Well, you're close enough. I mean, this is not...
This blade's about shot, too.
Well...
Doesn't take much.
One cut into spruce, if you get one good cut, it's enough. Okay, what a guy. That's good spruce.
Hard spot.
There you go.
Yeah.
Hey. The thing that we want to kind of figure out is the gear blocks... This would be how far back the spar is. I don't want the gear blocks to be really too far back.
Yeah.
Where are the gear blocks off of these plans?
Here.
These are the real Mylars.
I'm gonna turn them around.
These are the Spitfire or the Seafire?
This is a Seafire.
Okay. Well, let's see how far back the gear blocks are on this. Here you go, right here. We got them right here.
Well.
Measure reference off the leading edge if we can.
Well, here's the wing. Let's put this right on top here, Wendy.
Oh, lay it right on top. Even better. Look at this guy. What a rocket scientist.
Let's see how close I am. Oh. Wait a minute. This is where the truth...
This is where Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen get separated. Edge? Yes.
No problema.
How far back are we? Have quarter of an inch?
We have to come up a little bit.
No, we're...
let's see.
You're going to have to build a short torque box here.
This is...
Wait a minute. We right on the...
No, we're not on the line. Now we're on the
line.
Let's
see.
Boy, what accurate stuff. I'll tell you, you know your stuff.
Okay, wait a minute. We got to back off a little bit.
Okay.
Right there. That...
Okay, and how accurate is this now?
We're pretty good.
We're...
I'm not too bad.
Give me a number. An inch. I said it was going to be an inch.
Well, it's actually three quarters of an inch.
Okay, three quarters we could live with. We can live with three... The gear will cant forward.
While you have this out, you can see where I moved the trailing edge up.
Yeah, the trailing edge. This has bigger flaps.
Right. That's what you wanted.
Okay. Well, we're fine-tuning a really...
Well, can't you also just make a wider gear block?
Sure.
That seems like that's
the most practical way to do it.
It's a few grams.
Just a larger piece of plywood.
Yeah, you don't want to kink this.
No, that's not kinky. This is some beautiful set of drawings, by the way.
Okay, this is the part that you objected about. We got two-piece drawings.
Okay.
These are the originals, and I just wanted you to see those, and I'm going to unfold the other set for you, too.
They're beautiful. I don't care what Joe Adamusco says about these drawings. This is quality stuff. This is not paper bag stuff.
I wouldn't want to cut a set of these up for any reason.
No, they're nice.
This is
Hey, Bob, just think all the fun you're going to have drawing.
And you're going to do an I-beam and start all over again.
Isometric of that. Wait till he has to do this drawing.
I don't care what you say. This is a pretty impressive set of drawings. Anybody that's done better, God bless them. This is excellent. Now picture, this new fuselage will be wider by a quarter of an inch.
Yeah, Wendy said he's going to use, half by 5/8?
Half by 5/8 mounts on their side. So I'll have all the dimensions made for that. All new molds. But up here, where it comes to the spinner, it'll bow out more like a real Spitfire. Mm-hmm. It'll be a much more scale-like body. Okay. Much more scale-like. I mean, I just feel like we're building them light enough, we can do stuff like this now.
Those,
good drawing, I'm telling you.
Those come out, they're acceptable, I guess.
Yeah.
As long as nobody's complaining.
Where would you pay me $100?
Let's see now, what we laid out, you gotta lay, let's show this one, you gotta lay two pieces out. We've reduced the width of the spar, and we have the red line to work with. So now, this edge of the tape and this edge become the part to actually cut the spar slot for. And Joe's just paper dolling them. In fact, I'll get a blade and start cutting these suckers out. Then we can go have pizza, man. I hear the pizza parlor calling.
You know what's going to happen.
Yeah, well, think about maybe leaving these intact till all the ribs are traced out.
Why don't you make a full-scale spar out of whatever?
Make the spar first, yeah, see?
Then make some rims, then do some trial ballooning.
You're right. Once these have the slots cut in them, they're going to be vulnerable.
Right. Exactly.
See, now, it wouldn't be as vulnerable if you were doing full ribs. Okay? That's you understand why? Because then the other side would be
That's
the bridge.
Right. You'd have something.
You'd have the other side as the bridge to this. Okay, so we won't cut these. We'll just leave the tape
these
on.
These are the masters that I had glued to the table.
Right.
And I seen,
Right. Okay, so you're right about that.
But laying out is no problem here. And then when you all this confusion, like five-way conversations in here, you got to think by yourself how, because you're the man with this.
Yeah, well, this is, we'll think this through, that's for sure. We'll definitely think it through. I don't think it'll be a problem, but. This part of it I want to be really right, because once he makes plans and does the inking and the mylars, I don't want to have to go back and change them. And you can see, nice cup of coffee. I'm getting thirsty just looking at that coffee. You can see how much work he's got done on this already, and this is really, really nice. Consensus of opinion among the, just hold this back, is that I'll make these in full size without the spar slot yet, in 1/8-inch wood, and then just run four pinholes down into the wood and connect the dots to cut the slot, rather than
right there at the belt.
Cutting the slot. Once I cut the slot in these, I'm just afraid these will be too vulnerable. So, again, the advantage of having three or four people work on this is you can kind of circumvent some of these shortcomings that would make it more difficult to do. Joe, that's an excellent idea. I think we'll go with that. Excellent.
And, you know, just keep these in.
Yes.
If you gouge your rib up, you can always come back to the master.
Right,
and do it
over, right,
you know what I mean?
Right.
You don't want to, you want to keep your baseline intact.
Exactly.
And then work off those. Get prints, copies, cut them with scissors, paste them down. I should have the rod holes on there, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you got everything.
If you send those to me, Wendy, these drawings, a couple of times you folded drawings for me.
Hmm. Don't fold them.
And they won't lay flat.
Yeah, yeah, it's a mistake. You got to roll them. Always roll drawings.
Yeah. I'm not being unfriendly.
Always roll drawings. I got to remember that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mr. Ribs.
I was
ribbed out. And that was April of 97. I got ribbed out.
But we're 3 years into this project, and it's got to go to the next level. This just can't be another 20-point, just not another 20-point concourse top five plane. I want something special. I want something people will remember when I'm dead. In other words, the Spitfire, here's what we're trying to accomplish. We want a more scale-like tail. The Spitfire is 4 inches from this point to the hinge line, and that plane cornered real hard and had less than perfect stability. The Seafire is 3 inches, three and a quarter in fact, and it had real good stability but maybe a little trade-off in corner. So we want to go 3 5/8 from this point forward. That's right in the midpoint, and redo the hinge line. And I think we'll have the best of both worlds. And this can be made a lot more scale-like then. And this one has the curve in the front. It's a lot more scale-like too, because this looks better, Bob. This starts to look like the scale plane instead of these things being too long. Now that's where the hinge line would be. Okay. New hinge line. Now, if you just interpolate that line over, these things then are the right size. You had a little cutoffs at the right. See, each plane is starting to evolve into like a little bit more fine-tuned. What I'd like to wind up with is the corner of the Spitfire and the stability of the Seafire all in the same plane.
But look at this, Wendy. While you're looking at angles.
This is what we're trying to, maybe Bob can come over and look at this, is we have the curve in the leading edge now just about the way we want it. We want to move this over. Well, again, we're trying for more scale, the more scale look here, I think. That's the key.
Yeah.
Okay, now watch. This one is thicker here by some percentage. I think you need to do it by eye. I have a photo enlarger. You want to do a photo enlargement of this?
We can do just fine this way, I think.
If we do a photo enlargement, will we get that same taper?
Well, that same curve, yeah.
I mean, this curve here, you need to do with a ship curve.
Yeah.
It seems like this is more blunt than what we have on our drawings.
Yeah, and you know why.
A little subtle stuff. Yeah, that looks a lot more. It's all little subtle stuff, but
that's
once...
half inch bigger counterbalance.
Yeah. In fact, you could look at this drawing down at the bottom. The contour of the tail is just... I don't know, we got enough plans of Spitfires around it. It's the contour that I want it to look real scale-like.
Well, why don't you enlarge those?
I can photo enlarge that plan without a problem at all.
Yeah, that's just this part right here.
Right.
And ours is more elliptically shaped. This is nearly a straight line.
Okay.
And ours is pretty curved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this photo enlarger is okay. We're trying to get it up on. We're not even close
Did
to being
big
enough.
Did you read the instructions on it? What happens when you raise this off the drawing?
It just defocuses.
It defocuses.
Yeah.
But
we just need to be further away on something white that we can trace.
Yeah.
We're too close, yeah.
See that?
Or what we actually need is a bigger picture.
No.
Yeah. So we can get a bigger picture. Yeah, we can get
this
a bigger picture.
In
trying to do a more scale. So what I did, a more scale-like tail. I don't want to rip up my drawings here. Priceless drawings. So I took a little tracing of half of this, and I need to project that out onto a screen to make it, I guess, five times as big. We don't know how big we'll be able to make it. Maybe we can't even do this. I don't know. But this gives me roughly a totally scale tail.
See, this had like it came out elliptical.
Okay, genius. Oh, look at this. Oh, we have a scale tail.
If you had a whiter.
No, we need a piece of white paper on there.
Yeah,
a piece Mylar, of white, anything.
Do you have any white construction paper?
Sure.
8.5 by 11 if I do it.
Now, you might be thinking this is Bonner and Bailey's three-ring circus. It isn't. This is the scale detail tail being made. We figured out the length. And the width, and of course we're not going to make this exactly scale, but we know where scale would be. We get the angles this way. I tried doing this with a rudder, you know, like making it scale, just photo enlarging it on a copier. It didn't work. Didn't look right.
Yeah, can I get the fill the blank?
Yeah, and we can cut that out of cardboard, actually. We can cut it out of the box.
We could smooth that up a little bit.
Yeah, we could smooth it up, but this gets you in a ballpark anyway.
All right.
And
center line there.
How's that?
Okay.
Okay, so now you have...
Finally got to use your Christmas present.
Yeah, we have this made to the scale size that we need.
This is a little crude, but...
Well, we're pretty crude.
Smoothing her out.
All right, cut it out, baby. Okay. We've gone in three steps. We've gone from a little micro drawing to an enlarged scale drawing to a full... This should be real close to being scale. Now you just use this for reference. I mean, this doesn't have to be... what I'm saying is that this can be more like that, but it doesn't have to exactly be that. You know what I mean? We can interpolate the hinge line and everything. Okay, lay that on top of that, and let's see how close we really are.
Yeah.
See, it's way too large. So now you can get an idea.
I can get the relative contour.
Relative, right. We can steal that. In fact, we ought to cut it into a stab in an elevator.
What we could do is take... and trim, you know, like a half an inch.
Why don't you cut right down the center of that, this way, and then overlap them.
Yeah, you could do that too, right.
That's what I'm trying to do.
It's right here.
Yeah, right around up there.
Yeah, because we're going to redraw that.
Yeah,
that's easy.
We're going to redraw that.
Overlap it till you get it to...
I don't reserve steel.
You'd get a lot of that arrow shadow.
Where's that blue?
Yeah.
What do you need?
Triangle, tri-square. Yeah, that'll
work. Here's a straight edge here.
Okay.
You got it. And we're able to do this and shorten the span and make these changes is because we're going to have a longer tail moment. Both of these, actually Joe's too, all wound up. You never had any nose weight in your plane, did you, Joe?
Absolutely not.
None. So we in effect, instead of shortening the nose, we're going to make the tail an inch longer so that hinge line, the whole weight of the tail will be further back. It'll just make for a longer, more... Actually, it'll be more scale-like, if anything. And having that shape a little bit more scale-like.
Like so, Joe?
That's a good way to do it. There you go.
This would be too big to have a counterweight that way, but...
Well, here's one thing you could do, is you could move this curve to where you know that it needs to get bigger in the middle.
Yeah, like adjust it like that.
You could adjust it, yeah. You can adjust it.
Okay.
But if you do that, you're right back in the same place. You're just making your pattern.
You're just bending
fit,
the pattern
yeah.
to fit the...
Yeah. What, it's your old drawing.
What I think probably should happen here is put this thing together, and I'll trim half inch off the whole thing
right.
the outside, and then try and put this in.
Yeah, lay tape on there and just trim. Well, you do it by eye.
That'll work fine.
See, here's the difference if you look at them. Here's what we're changing is the aspect ratio. So in effect, it may be that you can change the aspect ratio of the whole tail just by adding this piece here and cut another inch out of the middle. In other words, this is probably, measure this against that. This is probably a 3-to-1 tail, and this is a 4-to-1, or this is a 5-to-1. It's the aspect ratio that we had wrong on the original models that isn't the same, you know, to be scale. This is a low aspect.
What if you just, you know, cut through here and forget the counterweight? You can always fudge at it.
Yeah, forget the counterweight
Take
altogether.
Take this up and cut that, just for the heck, while we're still doing something here.
This is really going to be the last project we could work on here anyway, but but having this in the bank, we're at light years ahead of where we were this morning at 8 o'clock, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, now we have something to start building with.
And then slice that straight down. Then we'll overlap that and see what that looks like.
See, just by looking at it, it just looks like that's wider, and this...
Yeah, there you are.
Exactly.
So we're going to have to add maybe a half inch to the front of that.
Right.
Because after the contour of the elevator is...
What would be wrong with that? What would be wrong with
nothing.
That?
Nothing.
Now see, the counterweight you can...
We could fudge the counterweight in. Yeah. Now because you're adding material here, you can lose a quarter of an inch of span to make up for that. So we don't wind up with some totally different amount of tail area. We know this tail area works good. Yeah, you can fatten this up. That's one thing you can do is fatten that up.
Now we can use the scissors and start trimming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, by accenting the point out here, what happens, it starts to look like a higher and higher aspect ratio. You can cheat the system by making that less of a curve.
And then once you get your overall plan form in, then put your, make the counterweight or counterbalance.
Yeah, you can put the hinge line and counterweight
whatever
in.
Looks good.
Just draw the hinge line in at 3.6 and do it.
That's the way we used to do it in the old country.
Yeah.
Yeah, Yakshimash.
Yakshi tail.
There.
It sounds like insignificant stuff, but when the plane is done, Bob, this
Bob's
stuff...
Bob's Croatian, I'm Slovakian.
Did they win the war in the old country?
Not yet. They're
still fighting.
They're playing cowboys and Indians.
Yeah. We got on the boats. The hell with the...
That looks a lot better. That looks a lot more scale-like without a trade-off.
Even if you, maybe come in here and just...
No, you don't have to do... That's fine up there.
Where do we end up with at the trailing edge of the...
We're close. Very much the same outline.
It looks so much better. It looks so much better.
You know when I was doing a rudder? You're going to laugh, but I spent a whole day. And one little eighth of an inch and the whole thing looks wrong. It's crazy.
And then where do you want to have your hinge line up in here?
Yeah, he's got the hinge line drawn in here.
Oh, the hinge line's going to be right there?
And then he needs to recalculate out this thing for the Rabe rudder here. That's a no-brainer. We could figure that out.
Now it looks like a Spitfire.
This looks, Bob, amazingly... I'm going to have to do the same thing with the rudder, too, to get the rudder exactly right.
Well, now, what happens if the counterweight's too big?
Nothing. The counterweight, is just going along for the
so
ride.
So, once again, you could go with a more scale-like counter.
Yes,
have you fellas
yes.
thought about...
You can go totally scale.
Putting any weight in the
I think that's important.
I think it is. See, this isn't the right counterbalance shape. This is, when we had it. The real counterbalance has more of an angle in it.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want a bigger angle here and I want a little more counterbalance.
Now, can you work off of this without a problem? You can make the real official drawing and just stick it in the mail to me, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a test to see if I can make this out of a solid piece of punk wood and get this razor bladed in the whole edge here. And glass it, maybe glass the whole thing, and then see, or try that carbon mat, and then see what this weighs. Because the plane, I'd rather do this than add lead to the tail. Yeah, this is going to definitely be, I think this is a major improvement right here, over just having it the way it was.
All right.
We can do that.
So we go with the hinge line in approximately the same
3.6 for the hinge line. He's got that calculated out. 3.6. And then you won't have to use the hole closest to the fuselage for the horn. You can use the middle hole. Because we know we have the furthest one down and the closest one to. This one will be right in the middle. And then you'll have adjustment. It'll be the best of all worlds. I think that's a major improvement. Just that one little thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Contour.
This is a great book. I was looking at that the other day.
Oddities. And, that's my airplane.
Oddities.
Fuselage
contour. Oh, life is oddities.
Most often don't match this contour, whereas the Spitfire is a true parabolic curve here in the front. And
Spitfire is one of the few planes that has that true parabolic front.
And I'm thinking that, you can do all kinds of things with these contours. Wendy's documented that when he made it. And we get a good pattern like this. You have midgley mold them out of plastic and then machine some of these back plates. That's the only thing, you just machine these. And
machining the back plates is the expensive. That's $27 a piece from Leroy Black. Could get them for $27.
Yeah.
It's still a lot of money, relative to...
But this contour, this is, I haven't drawn this right, but this contour, yeah, you can adjust that to fit the profile, just like the rudder shape and
yeah, exactly, this shape. Exactly.
Well, yeah, also, once you have this, yeah, once you have this back plate, you can do anything you want to with this.
That's
with
right.
This
if
section.
You want a straight cone, Mitchell, you can make a cone, or you can make one out of glass. No fiberglass.
Talking about the parabolic shape of that spinner. That spinner, it looks real easy to go mold that spinner. It is difficult beyond belief to get that right and get it to blend into the valve covers. And get this, it comes in and then goes back out. That is really something difficult to do on this plane. Not easy.
Well, interestingly enough, I bought every
early model ones. Just kind of, they look like true turn spinners, but not the ones that are parabolic. They have that big flat nose section.
And on, it takes
it's totally different. Okay. It's a little detail touch, but something you have to spend time and get right.
If you use that,
for example, how that spinner blends in. Boy, that's hard to get that spinner right too. That spinner is another thing that's difficult to get.
Yeah, you slap a standard spinner on it, it just loses its character.
Bob, I just thought of something. We got some pretty accurate shots of this spinner. We could photo enlarge it up to 2.25 to get the curve just right too. Like this one here is a pretty good on the contra props. This would be, if you could get this shape and then get it 2.25, you'd have a real good shot at getting it.
Well, you didn't miss it by much with what
But it took me 40 times to do it.
Well, you still got there.
Another example of that spinner, especially if you're going to do a five-bladed prop. So hard to get that right, just to get it that it looks right, even if it isn't right. I could look at this junk all day long. I mean, this is, oh my God. Here's Adam Musco in the cockpit going, quit looking at my spinner. Joe, are you going to put these nose things on your Suez paint job?
Not sure what I'm going to do yet. There.
What do they call these? Zebra stripes or something?
Well, some sort of squadron looking.
Yeah, I love that.
But my stripes are going to be narrow like that.
Heavyweight. The colors you're doing? The brown and orange. The stripes are orange and black, right?
If you have a good dope substrate, and do your wing up. You can punch through it, but yeah.
Let's look at widening up the body to a more scale body.
Me.
Yeah, talk about the wide body option here. Okay, we got two of the three things we wanted to do done already. The last one is to widen up the body, and we can start building here, baby.